So this isn't where I normally do videos. I recorded this entire video yesterday, and then the camera wasn't on, apparently. So, I've not had the best week. I've had zero sleep. I've been traveling since, I believe, 1 in the morning, and all I'm surviving on right now is 1 hour of nap time in the hotel bed, 150 milligrams of caffeine, and some Taco Bell. So you know what? Fuck it. Let's talk about Sheamus. You see, for the past few years, Sheamus has really entered into a bit of a career renaissance, becoming this amazing reinvention of his character as a brawling brute, as this vicious badass who puts on banger after banger after banger, and will kick your teeth down your throat before buying you a pint to wash it down. But the thing is, that wasn't always the case. As perfect as his character fits him right now, for the longest time, WWE quite simply didn't know what to do with Sheamus. The Celtic Warrior, the Brawling Brute, the Great White, the Alabaster Gladiator, he had like a million different nicknames, and in addition to that, he ended up having like 50 different finishing moves before finally settling on the brogue kick. It was kind of like Sheamus was WWE's little experiment that they would use to change out small things here and there just to see what would make him work, because when you have a big imposing force like Sheamus, you can't not do something with him. I mean, WWE will do anything to try to make a big guy get over. Look at Lars Sullivan. But in the case of Sheamus, it wasn't really needed because he came into the company with kind of already a working formula. His big debut on the main roster came just 4 months after he debuted on ECW, which wasn't really WWE's developmental brand, but it wasn't not their developmental brand, and as soon as he debuted, he entered into a feud with Jamie Noble, where every single week, Sheamus would just decimate Noble in this vicious one-sided feud that would ultimately see Noble quit the WWE, fully retire. Sheamus beat this man so mercilessly that he quit the company. He was like this ultra-violent version of Fit Finlay, just this crazed Irishman who loved to brawl, drink, and decimate his opponents, a character that it would unfortunately take Sheamus over a decade to get back to. It was unique to see in an era where WWE relied very heavily on the chicken shit heel trope. He was a bad guy that was good at his job. He was a villain that was arguably one of the most terrifying forces on the roster at the time. He was so good at his job that within 2 months of debuting on the main roster, he was facing John Cena on pay-per-view for the WWE Championship. And he won. It was a tables match, and as Cena attempted to go for a superplex off the top, Sheamus reversed and threw Cena into the center of the ring, directly through the table, and claiming the WWE Championship. And it all went downhill from there, because unfortunately, that is the moment where they decided to take everything unique about his character away and turn him into the exact same heel that everybody else was. He avoided Cena's attempts at rematches, ran away from him like a coward, and when Cena eventually does get his rematch, Sheamus simply cheats to win, gets a DQ, and runs away with the title. It didn't really fit the character we had been introduced to up until that point. He became basically the same cookie-cutter heel that everybody else was, and that's kind of a problem that plagued Sheamus throughout his entire career. Take, for instance, like a year later, roughly, where they turn him babyface. And by turn him babyface, I mean turn him into John O'Cena-cy, because that's all he was. He was John Cena, but Irish. The only problem was that in addition to trying to make him like John Cena, the company also was trying to make him like another top babyface from WWE history. Stone Cold Steve Austin. Stone Cold was like the ultimate anti-hero. He would do whatever it took to defeat his opponents, whether that was playing mind games by driving Zambonis down to the ring, or spraying them with a hose from a beer truck, or holding the arena hostage with a fake gun that he snuck in. Okay, yeah, Stone Cold was not a good man, let's be honest, but he was a badass, and it was a character that really fit Sheamus. But if at the exact same time they're trying to make him the face of the company and have him out there promoting the Be a Star anti-bullying campaigns, it doesn't really fit. It's almost like the company wanted him to be Mickey Mouse and the Punisher at the exact same time. In an article from James Gruby around the time, he actually ended up posing the question, is Sheamus being pushed or sabotaged? Because every single booking decision of his World Heavyweight Championship reign were more puzzling than the last. He would end up stealing a man's car, hitting him in the face with a boot, and ultimately defeating him, even though his feet were on the ropes. None of his victories and none of his actions really felt like something the top babyface in the company, the ultimate good guy, should be doing, but yet, Sheamus was there doing it every single week. And eventually, Sheamus would drop the title to young up-and-comer The Big Show at Hell in a Cell later that year. And losing the title meant that WWE had to get a little bit more creative with how they assassinated his character. Which, unfortunately, leads to one of my least favorite feuds in the company's history. Enter Damian Sandow. Now, Sandow was WWE's self-proclaimed intellectual savior of the masses. He would come down to the ring proselytizing about his intelligence and wit and how he was greater than everybody else in the arena due to his massive intellect. And as soon as he would get to the ring, he would analyze his opponent, look them up and down before deeming them completely unworthy of sharing the squared circle with him. And this went on for weeks. Damian Sandow was a wrestler who didn't wrestle. It fucking ruled. It's kind of one of my favorite gimmicks of all time. And eventually, the character grew to where he would come out to the ring and issue these series of intellectual challenges to his opponents. And obviously, the logical progression of this storyline should see the babyface come out, take on the intellectual challenge, actually defeat it, prove Sandow wrong, prove him a false prophet of intellectualism, and then ultimately defeat him in their blow-off match. Instead, what we got was Sheamus come down to the ring, attempt the intellectual challenge, get ultimately extremely frustrated before beating the shit out of Damian Sandow. It didn't matter. Like, whether it was untying the Gordian knot, taking on a computer genius chess computer, or playing the cups and balls game, which is fully not a, that's not a test of intellect. Like, that's a full-on carnival game. I'm not really sure what they were doing that week. But every week, Sheamus would come out, Sheamus would try, Sheamus would fail, and Sheamus would beat the shit out of him. And on one hand, I kind of see what they were trying to do here. They were trying to make Sheamus, you know, an everyman, someone everyone in the WWE universe could relate to. But that presupposes that WWE looked at its audience as a bunch of idiotic Neanderthals that would rather take an axe to a puzzle box than try to solve the mysteries within, which is arguably not the best way to look at your fan base. And ultimately, it kind of led to the degradation of Sheamus' character more and more, ultimately to a point where the company was forced to do what it did with almost all of its monsters, pull the plug and just do a complete hard reset on them. So they gave him a mohawk, braided his beard, and let him just start beating the shit out of people again, which is at least a start. If the current day version of Sheamus is like the best version of that character, this is where they finally started to dial things in. He was this hulking powerhouse who had finally turned his back on the WWE universe, furious at them for becoming obsessed with smaller, more agile competitors like Daniel Bryan, Seth Rollins, or Dolph Ziggler. They got rid of all of the frills around his character and focused on what they knew most, that he was big, he was strong, and he was Irish. That was about it. That's really all they had for him at the time. He was foreign, so they gave him his own foreign stable, the League of Nations, where a bunch of diabolical heels got together to destroy the rest of the WWE locker room, all united under one front The fact that they were from another country, that's really all they had for us at the time. They also decided to put Sheamus as the secondary villain in Roman Reigns' ascent to the top of the WWE, having him beat Roman for the WWE Championship in 18 seconds before losing it in like less than a month. And then eventually they kind of got rid of anything interesting about his character at all. As quick as the fun indie killer gimmick came, it was completely taken away from him. He became a bad guy for the sake of being a bad guy, a heel because WWE needed a heel at the time. But luckily, the next year, Sheamus would actually get a much needed shot in the arm, as he didn't just raise the bar. He was the bar. Teaming with Cesaro, now Claudio Castagnoli, the bar absolutely decimated the tag team division at the time, becoming one of the staples alongside the Usos and the New Day, and what was arguably one of the strongest tag team divisions the company ever had. They were kind of like a modern day version of the APA, and eventually a prototype for what the Brawling Brutes would become. They were just these two violent dudes who would come out to the ring, beat people up, and then go out to the bar. They were awesome, but unfortunately, the bar would eventually reach last call and force Sheamus to return to singles competition. So he took a few months off to kind of reset his character and refresh a little bit before finally returning as the alpha male of the WWE, this violent monster who would take out any smaller competitor that stood in his way, whether that was Dolph Ziggler or Seth Rollins or Daniel Bryan. This is really starting to sound familiar, actually. And it's also where we get to the main event of this bullshit they put Sheamus through card, as we arrive at what might be the worst feud of Sheamus's career, as he takes on a man by the name of Jeff Hardy. Now, quick content warning here, folks. All of it. If you're offended by anything that's tasteless, just leave right now. It's that this whole storyline, if you have issues with the stories involving drug use, alcoholism, drunk driving, if you got issues with piss, leave. Like, leave right now. There's like, think about how much piss you want in your professional wrestling storylines and like quadruple it. Cause like this story is like, I'll be honest, just go find another video at this point, because it's all drugs and piss from here on out. Oh, okay, I see you're still sticking around. I see you, dirty little piss goblin. All right, let's get into this. So, Jeff Hardy. For those of you uninitiated into the world of professional wrestling, the younger wrestle babies, as it were, Jeff Hardy has, I will say, a bit of a sordid history in the world of alcoholism and drug use. He is luckily now sober, but unfortunately, that little fact about him, that he is a recovering addict, has managed to sprinkle its way into just about every single storyline he's involved with nowadays. And sometimes it works out really well. Take, for instance, his feud against CM Punk, the birth of the Straight Edge Society, a feud that kind of got to explore the themes of sobriety through choice or sobriety through force, a really interesting dichotomy between the two. And then it also led to one of the fucking hardest lines in WWE history from Samoa Joe.
Keep on talking.
Hey, do me a favor. Why don't you act like this is an AA meeting and you shut your mouth while I'm sharing with the crew?
But after a while, you kind of start to get sick of the whole Jeff Hardy's a junkie storyline, because for those two examples I just gave, there's probably 50 examples of just tasteless, over-the-top, bad storylines. And this one with Sheamus, oh, it is the creme de la creme, the piss de la resistance, the ultimate bad Jeff Hardy storyline. And what's bad is that it didn't start out terribly. So Jeff was returning from a year-long hiatus, and Sheamus, attempting to cleanse the WWE of its weakest flames, snuffing out the weaker competitors like a true alpha male would, immediately targets Hardy, claiming that his history with drugs and alcohol had weakened him, that it made him a shell of the man that he once was, that he wasn't the true Jeff Hardy anymore. Kind of an interesting beginning of a storyline about redemption and proving that there is life after sobriety. Really fun themes being played on here. And then they ruin it. How, you ask? With a hit and run. So a few weeks later, SmackDown opens in chaos, with Elias having been struck by a vehicle that managed to flee the scene, with everyone accusing Jeff Hardy of committing the hit and run, claiming that he had been drinking earlier in the day. Later in the evening, during the main event, Hardy would actually return and assault Sheamus in the middle of the ring and beat him down, which, like, he is still, like, the main suspect in a hit-and-run case. Like, how did no one arrest him at this point? You know what I mean? But whatever. Wrestling logic. So it leads to a match between them at Backlash, and if you've watched our commentary on WrestleMania Backlash, you know where this is going. Because a week before the event, Sheamus comes out to the ring with an ultimatum, because he refuses to step in that ring with Jeff Hardy. He refuses to face him in that match until he takes a drug test. That's right, ladies and gentlemen, Sheamus wants Jeff Hardy to pee in a cup, but not just pee in any cup, pee in a cup on live television. So for at least 15 minutes of the 2 hours of SmackDown we get a week, we don't get wrestling. We get the Jeff Hardy piss segment, where Jeff Hardy comes down to the ring, Sheamus makes some fun jokes about drug abuse, and Jeff pisses in a cup. And, well, how else would you end a segment like that than by doing this?
Sometimes it's better to be pissed off than pissed on.
And, like, I don't want to be mean about this storyline, because, like I said, the beginning of it really had some legs. It almost felt like this was Jeff's attempt to get some redemption in his life, to attempt to prove to himself that he was still worthy of being called a superstar after all of his struggles. It really had some deep emotional connections in the beginning, but I'm sorry, when you throw piss on somebody, the whole window of redemption completely shuts on you. And then, like, a week later, there's this really weird segment where Sheamus, like, tries to tempt Jeff Hardy into drinking. He offers him a toast. He sends a sommelier down to the ring with a flute of champagne for Hardy. And then Jeff just beats the shit out of the sommelier, which, like, I'm sorry, that dude didn't do anything wrong, Jeff. Like, he got paid to do his job, and he did it. You could just say no. You could do a polite no. Like, that's all you really needed to do, Jeff. You didn't really need to beat the shit out of this man who was just trying to do his fucking job, but I don't know, that's just me. And eventually, we do get to that match at Backlash I told you guys about. You know, the match about redemption, the match about recovery, the match that was literally for the heart and soul of Jeff Hardy, to prove that there is life after addiction, that sobriety is the right choice. Well, Sheamus wins that match, actually. Yeah, Jeff unfortunately ends up losing that whole battle for redemption, but if we cut forward to a few months later, they end up brawling one more time. This time in an iconic bar brawl match and cinematic bout between these two WWE legends, and finally the charismatic Enigma would overcome the Celtic Warrior in their final battle. And this match would also see Sheamus donning the familiar wife beater and suspenders that would become an iconic part of his Brawling Brutes gear. Which means that the fucking piss storyline is responsible for the best thing to ever happen to Sheamus' career. So, I guess every single cloud has a silver lining. Even if that cloud is just fucking riddled with piss. So there it is, my retrospective on the worst of the Celtic Warrior, and also the first video I've ever had to record from a hotel room. Let me know what you guys thought about it in the comments below. And of course, make sure to subscribe to the channel. That way you get some more Fight Boys in your feed every single week. We got video game content. We got more video essays like this. Commentary tracks. If you'd like to see us commentate over that infamous piss match, go check out our Backlash commentary. It was the first one we did, and it's still one of my favorites throughout the entire time. And also, if you'd like to see the full commentary track for that entire pay-per-view, donate at patreon.com/fightboyshow. We upload the full commentary tracks for all of our commentaries, bonus content. I've done a few fantasy bookings over there where I'm like, this video is 45 minutes long. No one wants to hear this. But if you do want to hear me do some weird fantasy booking, you can see that over there. And it gets you access to our Discord where you can hang out with us. You can also watch wrestling with us every single week. I do stream wrestling. So, you know, if you wanted to watch wrestling, I'm just saying, a Fight Boys Patreon subscription is a lot cheaper than YouTube TV.
Patreon.com/Fight Boys Show.
And of course, as always, remember to like the video, leave a comment below, subscribe to fucking do whatever YouTube wants you to do this week. I don't know. But for me, just remember that when you're a Fight Boy, you're a Fight Boy for life.